Speak to us, Lord, during this time. Let us hear you speaking through Bob's mouth. Change us as we leave. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Hey, excited to be here with you all today. Roger is taking a little bit of a break. I'm really not sure why. I think they had some kind of event this week. I'm not sure. But anyhow, no, I want to tell you, I'm sure many of you were at the wedding, and it was absolutely gorgeous. I said this in the early services. Courtney was just gorgeous, and Brenda was beautiful. Roger was still homely, but the rest of them looked really, really good. So anyhow, I understand, too, that today, I think, is Roger and Brenda's anniversary, maybe about year 35. So that's impressive. So pray for Brenda. And anyhow, this is fun, man. I just get to shoot darts at Roger all morning, right? So anyhow, it is an exciting time to be able to be with you all this morning, be able to share from God's word. Hey, I have the privilege of working with the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association, and I'm their Missouri State Coordinator working with churches across this great state. And Franklin Graham, along with multiple other Christian leaders across the nation, have really called for believers to come together today on June 2nd and pray for our president. We want to pray for President Trump. We're going to stop for a moment here, and we're going to pray. I want to encourage you, though, not just to pray now here as our church family, but as often as the Holy Spirit would prompt your heart throughout this day. Pray for him. I mean, pray for him every day, but especially this day. We pray that literally hundreds of thousands of believers will be praying for our president. We want to pray that he would seek God's wisdom, that he would go to his knees every day and ask God for wisdom. Roger preached about it 2 weeks ago. If anyone lack wisdom, they ask God, he'll give them their wisdom generously. And if he's a believer, that he would grow. If he's not a believer, that he would surrender to Christ. That he would surround himself with men and women that know Jesus, have surrendered to Jesus, and that would advise him, and that he would listen for his safety, for his health, all those things. We want to pray for every president of this nation, all the future ones as well. Amen? And so we're going to pause for a moment and do that. There's some significant bills that are taking place right now. If you have any questions about those, Elaine Davis. Elaine, will you wave your hand right here? Everybody knows Elaine, all right? See her, and she can give you the details. I don't know anybody that loves Jesus any more passionately than Elaine. I know some that love as passionately, but any more passionately. She'll do that in a loving way, but she'll tell you truth. And so you can see Elaine Davis about those things. But, you know, the issue, the fundamental issue here in our nation is not a political thing. It's a spiritual thing. And it's the devil wanting to continue to take our culture a certain direction. It's always been spiritual. It's never been political. So we just need to pray as believers that there would be a revival in the church, amen, and a spiritual awakening across this nation. So let's pray right now. Father, we just pause for a moment, and we do want to lift our president to you. And God, I pray for his protection. I pray for his health. God, I pray that he would be a man that every day would go to his knees and seek your wisdom, seek your guidance, and that he would surrender to you, to your authority, knowing that you are the one really in control. I pray, God, that you would lead him to men and women that know you and love you, that would counsel him, and that he would heed to that counsel. He would listen and follow that. And Lord, we just pray, God, that we would see a revival in this nation through our churches. That's what's got to raise up. It's got to be the believers in this nation really surrendering to you. And God, I believe we see patterns time after time in your word where when God's people get right with you, spiritual awakening, lost people around begin to come to you. And so, Father, again, we think of that great passage, if my people who are called by my name. God, this is on us. So as your children, we come to you and pray. But today, especially on behalf of our president, God, keep him safe, bless him, and God, help him surrender to your wisdom, your leadership. Lord, we love you. We thank you. God, may you remind us countless times today to continue to lift him up. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I want to ask you to turn with me in your copy of God's Word this morning to the book of James. James chapter 1 and verse 12. James chapter 1, verse 12. We're going to be looking at verses 12 through 20. James chapter 1, verse 12 is where we'll begin to read. It's going to be on the screen as well here in a short time, and we're going to read that together. But if you have your copy of God's Word with you, it's always good to open, mark, underline certain words. You'll come back to this, especially this kind of subject, because today we're talking about how do you walk through the difficult days in life. Pastor Roger began a 10-week series 2 weeks ago out of the book of James. Roger came to Brad Russell and Brett Jones and myself and asked if we would tag team this, and it's a great thrill and honor to be able to do that. And so my opportunity today is part two of this 10-week series. So the name of the series, the title of it, if you would, is A Faith That Works, A Faith That Works, Godly Faith in Everyday Life. Hey, how do you really live faith out in a world, I mean, in real life situation, in this real world kind of situation? How does faith really apply to us during the good days, and especially perhaps during the days that we just absolutely get gutted? So Roger, 2 weeks ago, started this series, and he had in the bulletin some great historical information of the book of James. He shared much of that verbally as well. But James was written by God, but through the human instrument of James, the half-brother of Jesus. James was written to the Christian, the Jewish Christians of that day. At any time a certain group of people are written to in the Bible, guess who it applies to every day? To that same group of people. No, there are a few people in our church family that are from Jewish descent. Most of us are not, but I'm telling you, we're believers, we're Christians. So this book was written for the Christian of today as well. And today, what James, God through James, is going to instruct us how to do is how to walk through the tough times, the trials. Everybody say trials. See, in this first verse we read, I'm using the NIV this morning. In some translation, it'll use the word temptations, okay? And that's not a contradiction. Those words are interchangeable. But the bottom line is this. It's not just talking about how to walk with God whenever you're tempted. Sometimes whenever we hear the word temptation, we think of whenever we're being drawn away to do a certain sin. This is actually talking about whenever things happen, sometimes as a result of our sin, but many times also the result of something that's out of our control. You go to the doctor and you hear the word cancer. You go to the doctor and you find out your kid has leukemia. You have someone that you thought you could trust and love walk out on you, and you walk through the agony of divorce, and I've seen that happen to a lot better people than me. The times when life just guts you. James is telling us what to do as believers. Everything we're talking about today, remember, was written to the Christian. We got to look through that lens. How do we respond as believers to these trials? So how do we avoid the temptation of those trials? That's where those two words are interchangeable, so it's not a contradiction. But this is talking about how to walk through trials. So again, Roger started this. Here's part two in James chapter 1, verses 12 through 20. It's up on the screen, and I'm going to ask you all to read that entire passage out loud, okay? I read poorly, so I'm going to get you started, and then I'm going to listen to you, all right? So here we go. Blessed is the one who perseveres. Amen. Let's pray together. And Father, again, I've said it in the two earlier services, and I say it again. We don't stop and pray right now, because that's what we preachers do before we preach after the text is read. We stop to pray to say, would you help me and every one of us in this room to say, whatever you teach us, we'll obey. Would you help us to hear your voice? God, again, I've got to say, we do not need a motivational speech. And God, you know my heart whenever I say this. I don't have the goods to do that. But God, we need a word from you, and we need you to move us. We need you to move us, and we ask for that this morning. Help us to be doers, not just hearers of your word. Help us to listen, retain, and apply this week, today even, what you teach us today. And Lord, I'm thankful that we're not dependent upon a man, but we're dependent upon the power of your Holy Ghost to speak to us. We love you. We'll be careful to give you the credit. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, back to verse 12. Again, James telling us how Christians should respond in the middle of difficulties. Look at the very first word, blessed. Everybody say blessed. Say blessed. Blessed is the man who perseveres under trial. Now, what does that mean? Blessed is a man. I'm going to get up here where the light's a little, because my eyes are getting a little older, okay? So, blessed is a man who perseveres under trial. What does that mean? Well, I want to tell you, whenever a trial comes, whenever difficulty comes, if we want to have any shot as a follower of Jesus Christ of having peace, we need to persevere and hang on to Jesus, is what this is saying. Blessed, does everybody say blessed? Is the person who perseveres in trial. Now, I want you to know again, here's the situation with this. A lot of times, even as believers, whenever a tough time happens and hits our life, and I mean it's one of those situations where, man, it has just knocked our feet out from underneath of us, we have the tendency to say, God, why did you do this? Why did this happen? We have the tendency to blame God. God gets a bad rap for so much of this stuff. But what James is letting us know clearly is this. God is not the bringer of that trouble. God is not the cause of that trouble. But if we hang on to him, we'll be blessed because he will teach us multiple things and he'll walk with us through the trial. He is not the one that causes it, but yet some way, somehow, in his sovereignty, he does allow it to take place. I think the perplexing thing for many times in my little human mind is, okay, if you're almighty and you're all power and you're the superior being, God, why couldn't you have prevented this? Maybe you didn't cause it, but you could have stopped it. Why didn't you? And that's maybe one of the reasons why we have the tendency to blame God. But listen to what it says. Blessed is the man, say blessed, who perseveres under trial. If we have one shot of having peace, it's going to be running to Jesus, not running from Jesus. By the way, first and foremost, it brings honor and glory to God, and that's what it's really all about. But I want you to know that we're blessed. We may never have understanding of why. We may. He may actually give us a little understanding as to why. But we may never have understanding as to why. But what we really are looking for is not even understanding. We're looking for peace. And where we'll find the peace is running to Jesus in those trials. Now, the next part of this verse has another word in it that's intriguing to me. Because when he has stood the test, meaning the person who perseveres, when he has stood the test. Everybody say test. I'm telling you, whenever I hear the word test, what I have the tendency to think is this. It almost seems like God is throwing these things at us to say, okay, I'm going to hit you today, and I'm going to hit you tomorrow, and your day after tomorrow, and I'm just going to see how you handle it. Pass or fail, pass or fail. Well, you flunked that one. Hey, you passed that one. That's not what this is saying. What it's saying is this. We are in a broken world. This world is so broken because of the original sin and because sin runs rampant in every one of our lives today that we hear words like cancer, we hear words like death, we hear words like divorce, we walk through all these agonizing things, and it's not because God's causing them, it's a byproduct of the broken world that we live in. One day Jesus will come back and fix this place, but apparently it's not time yet. And as long as we live in these human bodies and as long as we live on this broken earth, we are going to have good days and we're going to have devastating days, and it rains on the just and the unjust. And I'm here to tell you that even it's going to happen regardless. It's not caused by God. He does allow it. But if we run to Jesus, he will allow us to walk through a testing time that will be second to none in our life. Beautiful and wonderful, not always. Agonizing, yeah, a lot of times. He'll fix it eventually and the pain will go away, probably not. There are some things that are so significant in our human minds that it will never be okay. We can live through it and walk through it with great faith. This passage is not saying, if you love God, you're going to fake it. Hey, man, everything's great with me. Everything's great with me, man. God's so good. Everything's great. Oh, yeah, God's just faithful. Hey, he is faithful, and we know those things to be true. But it's okay in the privacy of our home or with some other believers to be ticked off and absolutely walk through stuff that are agonizing and vent and be honest because God wants us to be God honest. The truth of the matter is you can't fake out God. He already knows, right? And God's fine with us being angry from time to time. He's a big guy. He's got broad shoulders, but we can't get stuck in it. But James is saying, whatever you do, don't blame him. It's not on him. That's not the situation. As a matter of fact, let's read on. So verse 12 again, blessed is the man who perseveres trial because he has stood the test and will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him. Now, what in the world does that mean? It almost sounds, if you pass the test, you're still going to make it to heaven. If you fail the test, you just lost your salvation. That's not what it's saying. As a matter of fact, to understand that, look at the last part of that verse, that God has promised. He's already made the promise, has promised. That God has promised to those who love him. Who are those who love him? Well, who's the book of James written to? Christians. So he's saying, look, believer, I've already promised I'm giving you heaven. Man, I've already promised. You can't lose that. I'll never let you go. But if you run to me whenever these terrible times happen that I'm not causing, but they are being allowed, but I'm not causing, you're going to learn some things, and I'm telling you all the more you're going to understand this promise that I have given you to those who love me. Now, verse 13 is huge. They're all huge, but here we go because they're in the Bible, right? When tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. Okay, now listen to this. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor can he tempt anyone. Now, I want to read it this way. When tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone with evil. Can you imagine God tempting someone with evil? It's completely against his nature. It's completely against his character. He's never going to tempt someone with evil. He's not going to throw a bad situation at you to see if you, just to test you to see if you swim out of it. That's not the way he plays. But because bad situations are going to be hurled our way because of this wicked, brutal earth that we live in, he's there to walk with us through it. He doesn't cause it. And we shouldn't be tempted to blame him. Now, there's two trails, or two rails, if you would, that we can run down here. And the first one is this. Many times we get in a situation, a trial, because of our own sin. There's been plenty of times in my life that I've made the mess. And it's been because of my poor choosing, because of my wicked heart. And I made the bed, and all of a sudden I find myself where I've got to lie in it. And I'm going to tell you, those are difficult trials. But how in the world would I blame God whenever I'm the one that made the mess? Okay, we still have the tendency to, and I think one of the reasons why the human beings have the tendency to want to blame God is because we're trying to make sense of it. We want to pass the blame somewhere, and it seems like he's a pretty easy target. And by the way, lost people always blame God as well. Don't live for God in any other time, but whenever a tough time comes, they want to say, God, this is all on you. But listen, here's the deal. The reason why I believe a part of what James is addressing is whenever we are in a trial because of our own sin is because he says in verse 13, when tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me, for God cannot tempt by evil, or cannot be tempted by evil, nor can he tempt anyone with evil. Verse 14, but each one is tempted when he, by his own evil desire, is dragged away and enticed. Verse 15, then after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. Now, the death the Bible speaks about there is eternity separated from God. It's a place called hell. This is written to the Christian. He's just reminded us of that. It's not saying whenever you sin, you're going to end up still going to hell, but it is. He is saying, hey, beware of being tempted to blame God, because here's the deal. Many times, whenever trials come, it's on you. But that's not the only thing he's saying. I believe the main rail that we need to stick with today is the main subject that God is writing through James, and that is, how do we walk with God through trials? Because many trials that come our way, it's out of our control. Whenever you go to the doctor and he says cancer, that's not in your control. Whenever you go and you find out that someone that should have loved you all your life bails out on you, you're out of control. That's out of your control. When someone deceives you and hurts you, and all these different things that are going on, when a child has an illness, all these different things that break our hearts, that's out of our control. So I believe that first part of verse 13 or 12 is so powerful. 13 is so powerful. When tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. Hear it again. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone with evil. So if God doesn't tempt with evil, and we know that stands to reason, who is the tempter with evil? Satan. So guess what? Whenever James is saying, don't be tempted to blame God, you know what he's saying? Because the tempter with evil, guess what? Who he wants you to blame? He wants you to blame God. Nothing thrills Satan more than when a follower of Jesus hits a hard time and then points a finger at God and says, I'm done with you. I'm walking away. See, the one that's tempting us to blame God is the devil. He wants people to seem like it makes sense to put it all on him, because he's the ultimate being. And even if he didn't allow it, even if he didn't cause it, he still allowed it. But James is saying to us clearly, Christian. Now remember, it's written to the Christian. This doesn't make sense to the natural man. Christian, whenever a tough time comes, a trial comes, and it's something that's not even in your control, you didn't cause it, but you're still being gutted by it. Listen to me. You trust God. You run to God, and don't let the enemy tempt you to say, that's on God. Don't do it, whatever you do, because it will absolutely wreck your life. And the only shot you have of having peace is to run to Jesus. Now, it's still, in my mind, I have to say, God does not cause it, but he does allow it. Why? If he's all-powerful, if he's almighty, couldn't he prevent it? Is there still a little blame that we can almost place on him in our humanistic thinking? Well, I want to watch a quick video here at this point of the message, and Ravi Zacharias answers this question. I've watched this video multiple times. I've showed it here once on a Wednesday night. I thought about watching it enough that I could just kind of repeat what he said. I just can't say it like Ravi Zacharias. And whenever you hear this, you're going to say, well, amen to that, okay? It wasn't supposed to be that funny, but thanks. But anyhow, I'm telling you, he explains it in a very unique way. So what I want you to be thinking about as you listen to this quick video is, why do bad things still happen? Why does God at least allow it to pass through his fingers when he could ultimately prevent anything because he's God? Why is that? Let's check out this video.
This question is for Rabbi. You mentioned the story of that, I think you said he was Jewish, and he was shot by, I think it was a concentration camp or something like that. And I'm going to play the devil's advocate for a bit and pretend I'm Sam Harris, no pun intended, of course. You stated that God was watching. God watched the gentleman pull the trigger. If God was watching, why didn't he make that trigger not work? Why didn't he make that poor individual just pass out while he was digging the grave? Okay. I believe Sam Harris would ask that type of question and demand an answer.
Yes, I appreciate that question. Playing the devil's advocate, you said that why didn't God keep the man from pulling the trigger, rather than allowing the man to pull the trigger and then watch over him and bringing about some kind of judgment. I would say this to you, that the supreme ethic that God has given to us is the ethic of love. It is the peak of all intellectual and emotional alignment. This thing we call love, which places value upon the other person of worth and as something to be protected. It was interesting, of all people, it was Oscar Wilde who, on his deathbed in his 40s, by his lover by his side, Robbie Ross, he turned to Robbie and he said, "Did you love any one of those little boys for their own sake?" Was an incredible question to ask by a man who was a hedonist on his deathbed in his 40s. And he said, "Robbie, did you ever love any one of those little boys for their own sake?" And Robbie Ross said, "No, I can't say I did." He said, "Bring me a minister. Bring me a minister." And it was in his magnificent poem, The Ballad of Reading Jail, that Oscar Wilde said, "Only Christ was big enough to cleanse his heart and forgive him for all that he had done." The point even the hedonist realized was that in pleasure also, value and love are the supreme ethics that can be treasure. But you can never have love without intrinsically weaving into it the freedom of the will. You cannot have love without the freedom of the will. If you are compelled by some machine to a certain decision, you can never love. You can comply, but you will never be choosing to express that sentiment and the reality of love. If love is the supreme ethic and freedom is indispensable to love, And God's supreme goal for you and for me is that we will love him with all of our hearts and love our neighbors as ourselves. For him to violate our free will would be to violate that which is a necessary component so that love can flourish and love can be expressed. If you're asking for God to always stop the trigger, why not God stop everything else? Next time you hold a cup of boiling water, he makes it frozen water instead. Next time you're about to cross the street and you're going to be hit, he pulls your leg back. What you're asking for is a different entity than humanity. As wonderful as it may seem that in stopping that, you think he is protecting you from that which is destructive, the greatest denial that you're asking for is the freedom of your will to be able to choose and to love God with all your heart and all your soul. When you've got love as the supreme ethic and the freedom of the will to choose that love, all of the other contingencies come in and can become explained why it is possible to either choose or to reject so that love can ultimately reign supreme. If you want compliance and some kind of a mechanical response, your question itself will self-destruct. You're asking the question because you're free to ask it, and you're free to ask it because you're free to love. And when you love him, in spite of all of the contraries that you see around us, you're trusting him for having the supreme wisdom and the knowledge to ultimately bring a pattern out of it all. We think, for example, we know so much. The story is told in Mideastern folklore of this man who lost his horse that ran away. And when the horse ran away, the neighbor came to him and said, you know, bad luck, isn't it? Your horse is gone. He said, what do I know about these things? A few days later, the horse came back with 20 other wild horses. And the neighbor came and said, amazing, it's not bad luck, it's good luck. You've got 20 more. Man says, what do I know about these things? His young son is going and taming one of the new horses. That young horse kicks him and breaks his leg. The neighbor comes and says, terrible, isn't it? Your son's leg is broken. Bad luck that these horses came. The fellow says, what do I know about good luck and bad luck? A few days go by and a bunch of thugs are coming looking for recruits to join their gang. And they're looking for all the able-bodied young men. And they're about to pick this young man but find out his leg is broken. And they say, we don't want him. We're going to move on to the next house. So the man comes and says, good luck, isn't it? Your son's leg was broken. In one little series of episodes, we don't know what lies ahead. Why don't you wait till you stand before God face to face and you will find out there were reasons why he didn't stop that trigger, so that you will see the heinousness of evil and see the majesty of love and good managing to navigate yourself as a pilgrim's progress to come to the celestial city.
So now you see why I let Ravi answer that question, right? Okay? Plus, I just can't get the accent down. So, anyhow, I'm telling you, I am so thankful that Joy Case Caldwell stood at my side on September 11th, I know, 9/11, 1993, almost 26 years ago, and out of all the men she could have chosen on this planet, she chose to love me, and she still chooses to love me. It's not a mechanical response, and as a result of that freedom to love, the result of the freedom that you and I have to love one another, to love other people, to love God, the freedom that God has given to us to respond even though we're wicked and sinners and should have to go to hell, and accept with freedom the love of Jesus Christ, with that same freedom, people have been given the freedom to do evil. And to ask the question, the freedom it takes to ask the question contradicts the question. I don't get it all, but I'm telling you, we are in a broken world. And God doesn't cause it. He allows it, but he's not to blame. But man, he'll walk with us. He'll walk with us. It was July 2nd, 2001. Joy gave birth to our fourth of five children, Hannah Elizabeth Caldwell. And on that day, I'm telling you, she had the best Apgar scale of any of our kids so far. Seemed as healthy as could be. Great day of celebration. Our doctor, Lou, who was a very dear friend, still is to this day, just talked to him last week. Godly man, led medical clinics all around the world in different third world countries, developing countries we had the privilege to take teams with, loves the Lord. He was our doctor. He had delivered over 1,000 babies at that point of his career. He didn't detect anything, at least if he did, he didn't mention, because it would be such a slight detection. And whenever Joy took Hannah to her 3-week well care checkup, Lou said, joy whenever I look at Hannah from a certain angle. It makes me wonder if she has Down syndrome. Now, many times with Down syndrome, they only have one crease in their palm. She had all three. Again, the features just were not distinctive at all as a newborn. And Joy called me and said, Lou thinks that Hannah may have Down syndrome. And I said, there's not a chance. There's no way. So the next day, Joy and I take Hannah back. We had blood drawn and some other tests done. And there was going to be a 10-day waiting period to find out if our little girl had Down syndrome or not. And Lou rushed the results to an 8-day process because he was going to be gone on days 9 and 10. And he wanted to make sure he was the one to tell us the news regardless of what that news was. So on the 8th day, it was August 2nd, 2001, at 5:04 p.m., the phone rang. And we'd been waiting for that call all day. And I answered the phone. And my sweet little bride walked over to me and said, is it Lou? Does she have it? And she could tell by my facial expression that our Hannah had Down syndrome. And I watched my wife crumble. Now, I'm telling you, they say that people live long that show their emotions. My wife's going to live to be about 120. She's always balanced in that, always very balanced, but she's just a very honest person. And she rounded the bases quickly, but very effectively. She went through all the things of anger, to denial, the different things. She came full circle in a pretty short period of time for having that kind of devastating news. The entire time, I was holding her saying, honey, we're going to get through this. God's faithful. It's going to be okay. And I'm so glad that she rounded the bases, because 6 months later, she was holding me while I was rounding the bases. And she was the one saying, honey, we're going to get through this. It's going to be okay. God is faithful. See, we men, we're not the brightest guys on the planet. You see, what we do whenever crisis comes, we have the tendency to lower our nose, hold on to what we know to be true, and thankfully for a Christian, it is true, and we hope our feelings will catch up someday. And sometimes, whenever they finally do catch up, it's pretty catastrophic. And that's what happened with me about 6 months into Hannah's life. You see, the things that kicked our tail were things like wondering life expectancy, health issues. We're still on a roller coaster there. We don't have life expectancy of any of our other children either. It's just heightened with Hannah. None of us have a guarantee of seeing tomorrow. The things that broke my wife's heart, no wedding aisle. For me, it was the words mentally retarded. It's a knife in my back. And I knew it wouldn't be a matter of if Hannah was mocked and made fun of. It would be a matter of when. And I would gladly go back to jail for any one of my kids anytime. Now I've got boys that are 6'4 and 6'5, and whoever does mess with Hannah better hope I get to them first, because they'll really put the hurt on them. But I'm just telling you, it was a heartbreaking scenario for us. It was the fear of the unknown. If I could have gone to a wall and flipped a switch in the first 2 years of her life and changed it all instantly, there wouldn't have been a close second. I would have flipped a switch. I would have changed it all. Now, this July 2nd, she turns 18. In the last 16 years, if I could have gone to a wall and flipped a switch and changed it, not a chance. A roller coaster still? Yeah. But I'm telling you, God has used that little princess to change all of our lives profoundly. It's tightened my marriage with my wife. Our kids love one another, and they're sensitive to one another, and they're sensitive to other people. I mean, God has used Hannah in so many ways. And what I've come to believe is that if Hannah lives to be 30 or 60 or whatever it may be, and she has Down syndrome all these days, and then she slips off to heaven forever and ever and ever and ever and ever, and just one life here on earth during those 30 or 60 years reaches out to Jesus and is changed as a result, and we've already seen that happen multiple times as a direct result of Hannah's life, then that's a pretty stinking good deal. I'm telling you, during those 8 days, I cannot tell you if I said it once, I said it a dozen times a day, I would look in her little eyes and I would say she does not have Down syndrome. And I was in full-time evangelism, Joy and I were, and we had a gazillion places to preach over the fall. I did, and she was singing, and I would say, I'm going to go to pulpit after pulpit, and I'm going to tell the story. They thought our little girl had Down syndrome. We had an 8-day waiting period, and our little girl did not have Down syndrome, and our God is so faithful. I'm going to shout it from the mountaintop, from every pulpit I'm in. And then the phone rang at 5:04 on August 2nd. And she had it. It was difficult. But God's used her to change her lives profoundly. I've learned more about God's unconditional love from her life. She'll have a better experience relationally than any of our other kids, because sometimes relationships just have a way of gutting you. But in Hannah's world, everybody loves her, and she loves everyone. Now, I want to read where we left off a moment ago in verse 16, and I want us to look through that lens. I want us to look through the lens of what Ravi shared. I want us to look through the lens of the trials that we can walk through, and listen to what it says. Do not be deceived, my dear brothers. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights. I want you to hear that again. Do not be deceived, my dear brothers. Every good and perfect gift is from above. God is the sender of the good gift. He is not the one that throws the bad at you. The bad's coming. We live in a broken world. We have the tendency to lash out at God. But James says, don't be tempted by the enemy who tempts with evil to lash out at God, because he's not causing it. He is allowing it. But if you walk with him, he's going to run you through something that's so much deeper. And it may never be okay. We're human. And the pain may never completely go away. We're human. But I'm telling you, God is faithful. That phrase that's in there is a unique phrase. Don't be deceived, my dear brothers. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights. That's an ancient Jewish title for God. Father of the heavenly lights. What it means is Father, meaning creator of all lights. It's literally talking about the stars and the moon and the sun. But the thing that's so cool about that is this. From the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like the shifting shadows. What it's saying is this. He's the creator. He hung the moon and the stars and the sun, and they're moving all the time. But the creator of those moving lights never moves, never moves, never moves. He is our constant. He is our anchor. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And we can trust him. We can trust him. It goes on to say, get this. On top of trusting him, he chose, say chose. He chose to give us birth through the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of all creation. Wish I had time to talk about the offering of the first fruits. We don't this morning. Listen, he even gave us a relationship with him. That's how trustworthy he is. If it's not good enough that he never changes and he's always there and he's an anchor, he chose to give us birth. That's how good our God is. We close with verses 19 and 20. My dear brothers, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen and slow to speak and slow to become angry. Now listen, again, he's on the vein of saying, how do Christians respond when difficult times come? Whenever we have the tendency to quickly, without thinking through it, lash out at God, and we speak that, and then anger comes out, and if a lost world hears us say, God, this is all on you, they're going to say, yeah, that's the God you trust. You don't even trust him now. How in the world am I ever going to trust him? Now, hear me. It's not about walking out in front and putting on some fake smile. In a private room or with a few brothers and sisters in Christ around you, yell, scream, be mad. It's okay. He's big. Walk through that process of pain. But listen to what James says. My dear brothers, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen and slow to speak and slow to become angry. For man's anger does not bring about the righteous life that God desires. So here's where we close. Have you seen my picture? I think everybody can see it from there, right? Let me tell you what that's a picture of. September 11th, 1993, this drop-dead gorgeous woman stood beside me and was crazy enough to say, I do, right? We got a lot of presents on that day, and one family gave us two boxes, two 12 sets of those glasses. That's actually a picture of one of the glasses. 24 of those glasses. In 1993, the colors were hunter green and burgundy with a little bit of mauve, okay? And you're saying you're a redneck from Sullivan. How do you know that? Well, I got married in 1993, and my wife decorated our first house in 1993. Trust me, everything was hunter green and burgundy and a little bit of mauve, okay? We loved those glasses. They were green. They were little goblets. We loved them. 24 of them they gave us. I guess somebody thought we were going to have a bunch of kids. I don't know, right? And I want to tell you why I took a picture of that one. It's the last survivor of those 24 glasses. Last one. And that was taken 3 years ago. We had a young lady that we knew her family well from Springfield. We knew since she was a little girl. She moved to our area because she was going to get her master's degree in St. Louis. And she lived with us for several months. And she was a photographer. And that's right whenever we had the last one. So I said, will you do me a favor? Will you take a picture of this glass? First, she took a picture and I had it empty. And I said, no, that just doesn't work because our life has never been empty. I filled it about halfway up just so you can see the level of water. And I go, no, half full isn't good because it's half full, you know. So I filled it all the way to the point where you see that little bubble crescent over where it's just ready to break. You know what I'm talking about? And I troubled the top, and it started to spill over, and she got the perfect shot. And I thought, man, that's been our life. It's been full. There's been trouble, but it's overflowing. It's overflowing. By the way, that glass since then has bit the dust. You say, why didn't you put it away on a shelf? Well, life isn't meant to put away on a shelf. It's meant to be lived. But I got the picture. 23 years, 23 of those glasses crashed and burned. The kid would have it, so one of our children, maybe full of milk, a little too close to the edge of the table, and bump with the elbow, and I'd hear a shatter and a, sorry, Mom. Not sure why they ever came to me with those, but anyhow, probably because they didn't want to step on the glass 4 days later when I hadn't cleaned it up yet. But sometimes it was me that had my glass of milk sitting too close to the edge of the table. Every once in a while, a dishwasher would get it. Had somebody asked me in the early service, did Joy actually break any of those on you? I said, no, I was quick then. I could duck those. It was the wall they broke on. That was the last one. Had this hanging in a previous office. I have it hanging in my home office now. Whenever people walk in, here's what they have the tendency to do. Not everybody, but some will do this. And they'll kind of stare at it. And I can tell the wheels are going. You know, they're thinking things like, you know, life with Jesus is overflowing. Bob's an alcoholic, you know, things like that. You know what I'm saying? So, but it doesn't make sense to them because they only see the snapshot. But I want to tell you what I see whenever I look at that picture, and I love looking at it. I see September 11th, 1993, whenever Joy said, I do. We were in full-time evangelism, and I see our first revival we did together as husband and wife. It was a tent revival in Knobnostor, Missouri. And I see our old 1986 Ford Aerostar minivan pulling into that tent. I see us getting on a plane about 3 weeks later, going to India for the first time. I see a lot of travel. I see the moment we found out that we were pregnant with our first, and our second, and our third, and our fourth, and our fifth. I see every one of those births. I see first steps and first words. I see some significant arguments, Joy and me. I see some hard times. I see our kids coming to Christ one at a time, getting to baptize them. Man, I see my son standing by one of the greatest women on the planet, getting married to her about 3 years ago. I see August 2nd of 2001 at 5:04 p.m. when the phone rang and my wife fell to her knees. See a lot of victory in that picture. You see, somebody doesn't know the story, only sees a snapshot. It doesn't make sense. But to me, that picture, it makes sense. And that's exactly the way it is with God and us. Something will hit our life that knocks us off our feet, and it does not make sense. We can only see the snapshot, and we cry out and say, why? Why would this happen? Why to me? Why now? This doesn't make sense. I am so angry. But if we're faithful to run to a faithful God who did not cause it but yet allowed it, he'll give you a story. He'll teach you things that are second to none. You'll find peace. You may never find understanding, but he'll give you peace. So I got to close by asking myself the question, who am I going to trust today? Who am I really going to run to when the chips are down? Am I going to trust others? I've done that before. I've been burned. And by the way, I've burned others whenever they trusted me. Am I going to trust myself? That never bodes well. Am I going to trust things? That's probably the funnest thing, to trust things, but it's short-lived. Or am I going to trust God? And who are you going to run to? You see, during those 8 days that we were waiting for the test results with Hannah, I said it time after time after time, I'm going to stand at pulpit after pulpit, and I'm going to say, they thought our little girl had Down syndrome. We had an 8-day waiting period, and our little girl did not have Down syndrome, and our God is so faithful. But I found it to be a much greater honor to be able to say from pulpit after pulpit, they thought our little girl had Down syndrome. We had an 8-day waiting period. Our little girl does have Down syndrome, and our God is so faithful. Because what we perceive to be good news or what we perceive to be bad news is never a test of his faithfulness. Our God is faithful. He's there. Will I trust him? Will you trust him? Let's pray together. Father, again, we just say thank you for your word, and thank you, God, that, man, you give us you during times that are agonizing. You give us a road and a story. You give us peace. That doesn't happen instantly, and it's not a matter of how great somebody's faith is as to how quickly it happens. I just think we have to be honest with you and do our best not to get stuck in it. But God, I can't help but believe in a group this size, there are some that are in the middle of a crisis right now. And we already know that it'll be every one of our turns soon. And it's been our turn in the past. And so, God, we're in this thing together. But, man, we have you to run to. So, Father, I wonder tonight or this morning if you'd help us to run to you. Realize all the more, you get a bad reputation sometimes. Some people want to blame you. You never have a bad reputation, but they want to blame you. Man, we just want to say, you're who we're going to embrace. So God, during this time, your invitation, we'll be responsible and respectful, not manipulative. We know it's yours. God, I do pray for courage all over this place. We love you. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. In a moment, we're going to stand, and David's going to sing in this team. And here's the invitation this morning. If you're here this morning and you say, you know, maybe I'm in a crisis, or maybe I just want to be ready for the next one because I know I live in this broken world, and it'll come. There's something special, I believe, still about an old-fashioned altar. And God's people had come to an old-fashioned altar and bow a knee before a holy God that says, I will never give up on you. I'm never letting you go. You just try to get away. Won't do it. I love you. On your worst day, I love you. I wonder if we could bow a knee before that holy God and cry out to him today and say, God, I just want to be hanging on to you and running to you in every circumstance. I want to thank you for getting me through the past ones. But maybe there's some people here this morning that would say, Bob, I know the book of James is written to the Christian, and I know you're asking the question, who are you going to trust and who am I going to trust? I don't know that I've ever really trusted Jesus fully in the first place. I'm not 100% sure that if I died tonight, I would spend eternity in heaven. You can know that, and you can know that before you leave this place. And in a moment, whenever we stand to sing, I'm going to ask you to do something that's going to take some guts. But this whole Jesus thing is a passionate, radical thing. I'm going to ask you, maybe there'll be some others coming to pray at this old-fashioned altar, but if you're here and you don't know you're going to heaven whenever you die, I'm going to ask you to make your way right here. I'll mute this mic, and if you're at a loss for words, just say these three words, I don't know. I don't know. And I'll know you're saying you don't know you're going to heaven when you die. And listen, I'll direct you to someone right here at just a few minutes' time. We'll share with you from this book, God's Word, how you can know. How you can know. Who are you going to trust? Let's all stand as we sing right now. You come. As you need to come, you come.
Save the wreck like me.
let's just for a moment, have heads bowed and eyes closed. And David's going to sing one more time through this great, great hymn about faith. And if you need to come, you can just quietly open your eyes and make your way out. But heads bowed, eyes closed, as David sings his last stanza, you come.